The great thing that I noticed when I came here, that was the best moment of the day already, that you put me in the pink room. Yay, awesome. That's one of my favorite colors. I'm not embarrassed to admit. So yeah, some of you recognize me or know me from some of these books, Mentor 3.0, the one that sort of made me famous, quote unquote, in the small agile world out there. I wrote How to Change the World, a little self-publishing experiment. You can get it for free by just going to that URL, subscribe to my mailing list, download the book, and unsubscribe. Easy. Right? Anyone can do that. It's easy. And the last one, Managing for Happiness, I wrote 3 years ago. But this is not about those books. This is about agile transformations and continuous information, and it starts with this picture. I am so old that I remember what happened over there, which is off screen. The 80s is my favorite music era, basically, with my Sony Walkman on my side and 13 songs on each side, and I had to take it out. Oops, tape got stuck. And then CDs became big, a little bit of patriotism there. Philips played a big role, Dutch company, yes. And then in 1999, something happened, as you can see. Does anyone remember what happened in 1999? Napster happened, yes. Illegal downloads of MP3s. Now, the experts disagree on how much of an effect Napster really had, because they said those people downloading illegal music, they were not buyers of CDs anyways. But then I say, well, then what else happened at exactly that moment? Because something was going on. And this, of course, freaked out the music industry, and revenues were collapsing. And this happens again and again in many industries. This is called The Innovator's Dilemma. It's a book by a much more famous person than I am, Clayton Christensen. He said, in many industries, it's the same thing again and again. You have these leaders in an industry. They make lots of money with their current business models, but they are disrupted by the new ones that start with alternative products that in the beginning are worse, lower quality. Downloading MP3 music from the internet was slow, it took you an hour, and then it was the wrong album. Oh, God. And then it was low bitrate, but there was something else, which was the instant gratification of getting it online. That was what the younger generation wanted. And then they evolve faster and replace the incumbents, as they say. So this happens again and again, and of course this worries the executives and top management, and they want to do something about it, and they want both, basically. They want to execute their current business models over there, but they also want to explore and disrupt themselves, basically, with new ideas and new products and services. How can we be a little bit of both? How can we have a startup culture, but we don't want to lose the scale-up culture that we already have, because that's how we pay our bills, that's how we make our money. And it's possible to do that. But people struggle. There are some examples. Innovation committees, for example. I was once part of an innovation committee. Wow, that was so much fun. 15 years ago, me as CIO of a company where I worked, and there was a CTO and a marketing manager, whatever, and we had ideas submitted by the employees to the idea box, and we looked at the first idea, and that was like, that didn't make any sense at all. Next idea, that makes a lot of sense, but that costs like €1 billion. Are you kidding? We cannot afford that. And then a third idea we threw away, and then, oops, the box was empty. We rejected all the ideas, and then the employees were angry. You're rejecting all our ideas. And we said, you should submit better ideas, idiots. And that didn't really work. That did not work. And other companies have other methods. They have innovation centers that they intentionally put elsewhere, otherwise the parent company is going to kill the R&D center. So they put it elsewhere, in another location, another city, another country sometimes, far away from the mother organization, with fancy pillows and Aeron chairs and yoga mats and everything, and let them be creative. But then the complaint from the mother organization is, there's nothing ever coming out of that. We pay for that fancy stuff, but I haven't seen an innovative product in years. And the last complaint I hear is about hackathons, which is super, super interesting practice, 24 hours of experimentation and playing, etc. But then people tell me, after the hackathon, nothing happened. We were very creative, but the organization has no program or whatever to pick up the best ideas and continue. So then people get demotivated again. So we have to do something about that. And I'm sure some of you recognize some of these pictures, Agile frameworks, SAFe, Xscale, DAT, Less, Holacracy, Spotify model, whatever. All great stuff, nice toolboxes, but none of them solve the innovator's dilemma. None of them explain how you can be a scale-up and have a startup culture, do both at the same time, make lots of money and innovate with new products and services. That's not explained. So we need more. I'm going to solve the innovator's dilemma this morning. Yep, I will show you. It contains three keys that I hope you will remember afterwards. Let's first have a look at the disruptors. I wrote this book, Startup, Scale Up, Screw Up. That's my new book. And I traveled around Europe, talked with the Flixbus in Berlin, Brainly in Krakow, TransferWise in Tallinn, Spotify in Stockholm, and many companies. And it turns out that they have a common language of the stages that a business model goes through. And it usually starts with stage one, someone has an idea. And put it louder, yeah. Thanks.
iPod, 1,000 songs in your pocket.
1,000 songs in your pocket, wasn't that amazing? I had just 25 songs in my pocket at the time. So 1,000 was like, whoa. Now we have 1 billion songs in our pocket and people are like, doesn't have my favorite album on Spotify. God, a bunch of whiners. So, I had just 25 songs in my pocket 20 years ago, okay? So, so that was an idea. The iPod, Steve Jobs said, I can do a better job with MP3 players. They were already on the market, but they were all very complicated, and he did indeed an amazing, amazing job. That's the product vision. Stage one, a founder has an idea. And then stage two is problem-solution fit, as they call it in the startup scene. You have to test whether your solution is actually making sense to people. Before investing any time and resource and funding in it, validate that you're actually solving someone's problem. This stage has been skipped by almost the entire cryptocurrency blockchain world out there. It's people, tech people, falling in love with the technology and then they started coding right away. Wrong. Right. You have to validate problem-solution fit first. So you have an idea, is this making sense to someone? For example, I like talking about coffee, you will notice. Imagine that I want a new coffee bar somewhere in the street. That would be an expensive assumption if that is not the right street to open my coffee bar. So I could have a lean experiment. I could say, well, my assumption is that the best location for my coffee bar is in Side Street. I'm going to sell coffee from a mobile coffee cart for a day. And then when I sell fewer than 50 coffees on one day, I will consider my experiment failed because apparently there's not enough demand for coffee in that street. I will run the experiment again in another street until I found the right spot. And that's where I will then open my coffee bar. That's a lean experiment. That's how you will test if there is demand for your idea. Kickstarter is full of problem-solution fit tests. Right? The products don't exist. They're just fake mock-ups, prototypes, video rendered products that don't really exist. They just test if there's demand. You save yourself a lot of trouble not building a product that nobody wants. Stage three, imagine you test it, you validate it. Everything seems to be okay. Now it's time to invest with funding. You find a team. We can call this Vision Founders Fit. Vision Founder Fit. And external startups will have to find funding through angel investors. Internal startups will have to find a budget from the executive team or something. And you could start canvassing. Lean Canvas is a popular tool to describe your business model. And an adaptation from the business model canvas that we will see a little bit later. For me, those canvases are simply categories of experiments to test, right? You need to run experiments in terms of, where is it, over there, revenue streams. We have to run experiments in terms of the solution and the customer segments, experiments everywhere. Stage four. Then we have a team, we have funding and everything. Now we build the product for real, and then we iterate the hell out of it. This makes total sense to anyone in the Agile community, of course. I don't have to explain this. In lean startup language, they call that problem product market fit and building minimal viable products of the high fidelity type. The fake products in the earlier stage were like the low fidelity type, the landing pages, the videos, that's low fidelity MVPs. Now we have a high fidelity MVP, we actually have a product, but it's still simplistic and we experiment and we iterate. And hopefully at some point we have something that works. This is, according to some startups, the most difficult stage. Because it's very easy to get false positives on your idea. Oh, that sounds like a great idea. If you open a gym in the city, yeah, we need a gym. I will sign up. I need to work on my health. Yeah, yeah, do that. And then you open the gym and nobody comes. They even subscribe, they even have a membership, but they're not showing up. It's so frustrating. Then your product market fit is not working. So that's stage four. And stage five is stabilization. Suppose your product works, you have iterated the hell out of it, are you then ready to scale up? No. No. Number one problem I heard time and time again is that startups scale up too fast with their product or their service. They're not ready for it. If you did things well, then you faked everything in the back end. You only worked on the front end facing stuff for products, for customers. Are they willing to use my product? In the back end, you're going completely crazy. With everything is manual, technical debt is going through the roof, all that kind of stuff that needs to be fixed first before you attempt to scale up. That's one reason. Another reason is that you're changing from one audience to another. In the beginning, you work with the early evangelists, as they call them in the startup world, the innovators and the early adopters. They will love you for your idea, and if they find a bug, they will report it to you and feel proud that they're the first ones to find that problem. And then you change to the early majority when you scale up. They are different people. When they find a bug, they're not going to tell you. They're going to tell all their friends on Facebook. That's not what you want. So quality has to be ensured by that time. Customer service has to be set up. All the systems need to be integrated. That's the stabilization stage. And you can call that business market fit. And by this time, you can switch from the lean canvas to the original business model canvas by Alex Osterwalder, because he has a few different boxes, like key partnerships. Yeah, that makes sense from stage five to discuss key partnerships, because as long as your product doesn't work, no partner will be interested in it. So it makes no sense to run many experiments there. It makes sense to do that from stage five when you're stabilizing with a product that works. And then stage six. Now we get to the teenage years of the product. By the way, the pictures are of my mother. Growing up, she was so proud. She's in my presentation. She spent a whole weekend finding photographs of all the stages of her life. This is amazing. And you can see from the look in her eyes as a teenager, she discovered new possibilities as a human being. Everything changes when you're a teenager. I'm sure some of you remember that. Same for the business model. And one thing that becomes interesting from this point is growth hacking, for example. I made the mistake of sending my team, startup team, to a growth hacking course last year. Stupid. Because we were in product market fit. Stage four. We were still trying to make a product that works. The whole idea of growth hacking is that you tweak endlessly the messages and the buttons and the text and the colors and everything to get higher conversion rates, increase the effectiveness of the conversion of customers. And that works if you have something that a product that is already working for people, basically. But we did not have a product that worked. So multiplying by 1,000 something that is zero You still have zero. It makes no sense. Right? So growth hacking you do from the moment you have product market fit, then it makes sense. And then you can scale up. Stage seven is basically where Spotify is right now. They have grown up and they've cornered the market. They're one of the leaders in their industry, making money. One time I hear they're profitable, another time I hear they're not, so I find that a bit confusing. Anyways, they've grown up. And stage eight is expansion, midlife crisis of the product or service. Try to stay relevant. If you find a product that appears in 16 different colors, you know that the end is in sight. Okay? They ran out of ideas. What else can we do to keep our product relevant? Oh, a pink version and a blue version would be nice. Why not the entire rainbow? Great idea. Okay, there we go. Lots of product versions. And stage nine is, okay, well, that's the beginning of the end, basically. The senior citizens in our company, as far as the business models are concerned. Everything is achieved. People are walking away. Maybe the product isn't even profitable anymore. It is just costing us money, keeping it alive. And then stage 10 is, okay, let's just admit this is it. We're making it a project to stop everything. We stop customer support and we offboard everyone in an elegant way, getting them onboarded onto younger products and services. This is a typical life cycle. This is an archetypical life cycle of any product or service, any business model. This could take 2 years if it is a game. Like I was at Rovio in Helsinki, the makers of Angry Birds. They say this takes 2 years and then it's over, done. Next game, continuously producing new games. Or if it's in the finance world, this could take a century with some kinds of products that they have. So the life cycle duration can change, but the pattern is very much the same. And you see here the pattern of the iPod. Right? It started in the early 2000s. Product market fit, stage five, stabilization, rapid scaling up, yay. Stage seven, we are the leaders, yay. Stage eight, oh my God, what do we do? Midlife crisis, let's make a pink version. 9, 10, dead. And that's typical for many life cycle, many products and services. Now, what I learned, and this is the first key to solving the innovator's dilemma, the rules should be different per life cycle stage. Do not treat everyone the same. This is a family picture. You can see that I was one of the first people in the world to wear these sexy pants. Very fashionable nowadays. I'm the trendsetter, I can tell you. And this is my little brother, Jeroen. You can look, you see from the look of his face that he was planning something devious again. And that's my little brother, little rascal. My brother said to my mother that it was unfair that I was allowed to come home anytime I wanted, and he had to be home at 6. It's not fair, he said to my mom. Well, first of all, my mother said, Jeroen is 3 years older. He's in a different life cycle stage, duh. And second, maybe you can earn the same rules as Jurgen has if I don't have to pick you up from the police station anymore. Little rascal. One of favorite family anecdotes is when my mother got a phone call from the police office at 5 a.m. in the morning. Yeah, we have your son again. You wake me up for that. God, I'll pick him up at 10. I need to go to the supermarket first. My brother is all right now. He's a wonderful, wonderful person. But my God, the stories we have. So, the rules are different. And as an example, OKRs. OKRs are all the rage nowadays in the agile world. Makes total sense. I'm not going to explain how it works. Google has popularized them, but they're used in many companies. In the startup scene, nobody talks about OKRs. Nobody. I haven't heard it a single time. They talk about the North Star metric, the one metric that the self-organizing team will try to optimize. It could be daily active users, could be monthly recurring revenue, or it could be a customer-facing North Star metric, such as the minutes of player activity per month per user, which is a proxy for the value that a customer has for the service. And then I thought, so the young business models usually do North Star, and the adults seem to like OKRs. Why not both in an organization? Why don't we just allow the young business models, the people working there, to use North Star metric without forcing OKRs upon them, and let them switch to OKRs when they grow up? Makes total sense. Why should everyone behave in the same way? Why should we all have the same framework across the entire company? It should depend on the business model that they're working on. Form follows function, right? So the function is the business model. Therefore, the form has to match the business model that you're trying to build up. So different ages need different practices. That is one of my takeaways of the last year or so that I think is very important to take into account. And that is the first key to solving the innovator's dilemma. And we're going to go to the next one. Second key starts with this picture. Design thinking is, oh, I love that kind of stuff. I read the books, I talk with design thinkers, I try a little bit of it myself, but I suck at it, but at least I'm trying. And it's famous for a focus on empathizing with users, trying to understand people's needs, and then defining what they want, and then coming up with ideas, prototyping, testing, etc. All makes a lot of sense. There's just one small issue. I hate this picture. Anyone guess why? Sorry? No pink. That's a very good one. Yes, I will add down. There's no pink in the picture. I will grant you that one. Thank you. There's another reason why I... It's not iterative. Where is the cycle? Yeah. It even looks like a waterfall, this part here. My God. And so if you show a picture to people who do not understand what they're doing, and the picture is like this in stages after each other, they will interpret things as waterfall. This is exactly what I hear is happening in the industry. So we're going to empathize in the first week in November, then define the later 2 weeks, and then the ideate we can do in December. Prototype will then will after the new year, and test in February, and then we launch. Waterfall, yeah. Not intended. Design thinkers say all the time, this should be iterative process, or cyclical, etc. And then I tell them, then why do you paint a picture like this? You're designers, duh. You should understand that this doesn't work for some people. Same with this one, the Design Council from the UK. The other one is from the US, D School, Stanford University. So I love design thinking stuff. I just don't like the way the pictures are drawn. We can do better. I like this picture better. It's the Lean Startup model. Build, measure, learn. At least it has a cycle in it. What an amazing invention. It goes round. Oh, wow, wonderful. There's just something else that is a problem, in my opinion. Anyone care to guess? What's the problem with build, measure, learn? No hypothesis indeed. Where are the ideas coming from? Falling from the sky? Where's the customer here in this picture? So the lean startuppers say, when you read the books, Eric Ries, they say, get out of the building, just look at what people are doing, understand their needs, of course. You can even buy t-shirts that say, get out of the building. But it's not in the picture. It just shows half of lean startup thinking. So I thought, I can do better. This is where I come in. I am really, really good at stealing stuff from others, borrowing, basically. And then matching it and doing a bit of pattern matching and connecting the dots. And then I thought, okay, so this is what we have here. We have a couple of pictures that suck from the design thinking. We have a picture that sucks from lean startup. This is how they map. Learn, I like that from lean startup, that they make a distinction between measuring and learning. They don't have that in these pictures. They just implicitly assume that when you run a test that you learn from it. I like mentioning in it separately. And the first part is entirely missing in this picture of lean startup. And something that all of them miss is something that design thinkers call framing the problem. When you empathize with someone, you've already made a decision which people to empathize with. There are nearly 8 billion people on the planet. I cannot empathize with everyone. I have difficulty empathizing with two people. So 8 billion is a stretch for me. So I have to narrow my scope and say, okay, I'm going to solve the problems here and I will leave those problems to other people. Good luck with them. This is my territory. So that is the context, defining the context, framing the problem. I thought it makes sense to add that. And then I thought, I want a new picture. I want it circular. So I came up with this. I added lots of colors because I'm in my midlife crisis. Three colors, pink is important. And I looked for alternatives to the word circle, and then I found a vortex. And I said, yeah, I love vortex. It sounds powerful, it sounds amazing, it's less boring than circle. And with the vortex metaphor, you have the additional benefit of people associating that with tornadoes and whirlwinds, and it is dynamic and a little bit chaotic, maybe even. Yes, that's what innovation is. Everything can happen at the same time. Design thinkers never claimed that you do all that stuff on different weeks or days, step by step. Design thinkers have told me my work is total mess. It's anarchy. On Monday morning, I could be empathizing with customers, and on Monday afternoon, I'm looking at the results of tests, and on Tuesday morning, I have hypotheses, and it's everything into each other. It's like a vortex. All the streams of work swirl into each other, basically. So I have a couple of examples. What is the stuff that innovators and design thinkers and lean startuppers could be doing? Well, this is a picture of an empathy map that one of my teams created a couple of months ago. With an empathy map, you try to empathize with your customers, your users, by just collecting everything that they see, that they hear, that they talk about, that they say, that etc. On a big wall, just diverge in your thinking, capture the experience of your users, and that creates a little bit more empathy with them. And then what you could do next, as a next step, is then converge and formulate an archetypical persona. Now, can we describe that person with a name and some details, such as our user is Mark, he is 34 years old, lives in Amsterdam, loves specialty shops and coffee, and commutes on his bike, because he's Dutch, obviously, and no coffee on the way to work. That's a bit of a problem. Now we have a picture of Mark. We have a picture in our minds of our user, and we can solve Mark's problem. It turns out that with lean personas, it is easier for product teams to understand whom they're building their product for. Such a story is easier than just some demographical statistics about the target audience. The people don't empathize with statistics, but they empathize with people, even if the people are fake characters like in movies, etc. So a lean persona, that makes total sense. And then we have to understand, what is the job to be done? Is Mark just looking for great coffee? Or does Mark need a bit more on his way to work instead of just high quality coffee? Well, I can tell you, when I go out for coffee, I don't want just great coffee. I want a place to sit for an hour or two, comfortable chairs, and decent Wi-Fi would be nice, right? That's a package of three things. Starbucks has called this the third place between home and work. Offer people a chance to sit and talk or do work with good coffee, decent coffee, good chairs, and good Wi-Fi. That's the whole package, is the job to be done, the problem that needs to be solved for someone. If a coffee shop just offers coffee but no chairs, I'm not even going to buy the coffee because I can't sit and work. So you're not solving my problem. Where does all of that sit in the vortex? Well, clearly, empathy maps is empathizing, lean personas, that's defining the next stream. What was the next one? That was the job to be done. Yeah, job to be done. Also here, synthesizing. And then over here, we can have lean experiments. That would be our hypotheses and the tests that we're going to run. Another practice that I like talking about briefly, the journey map exercise. I did that with my team once. We found it quite difficult, but it's a super interesting challenge. With journey mapping, you try to describe the experience as a story that your user, your customer has with your product by identifying the various touch points that they have with your company and your product, and then figuring out where do they have the wow moments and when do they have a what the f moment. And usually the what the F moments happen more often than the wow moments. You need to know, right? You need to know, realize this. So it is testing, sensitizing what is the experience of people with our product. And understanding where the touch points are. For example, when I go for a coffee in a strange city, I travel all the time, the first touch point is Google Maps. I open Google Maps on my smartphone, I type coffee, sort by distance, open now, top rated, then I go to the first coffee bar that looks like they have chairs and the word barista somewhere in the description or something, or self-ground coffee beans or whatever, you know, some description that triggered me. So I walk to the coffee bar, it could take 20 minutes, nice weather, etc. I arrive there, no coffee bar. What the f How hard is it to maintain your address details on Google Maps? It's not that difficult, okay? That's your first touch point, you already failed. All right. Find another one. Okay, we'll go there, 10 minutes, close for the holidays. Okay, next one, Starbucks. Anything is fine. I need my coffee now, because I go nuts. Okay, 5-minute walk. I arrive at a coffee bar. It looks amazing. Lovely, wonderful chairs and people working there. Seems they have Wi-Fi. Oh, fancy espresso machine. Oh, this is going to be great. I order my cafe latte, and I get a latte macchiato. What the fuck? And this is typical for Poland.
Welcome.
So, I'm on a mission here in Europe. Let me explain something to the Polish people and the Germans. On this side, the latte macchiato. It usually comes in a glass. It is milk first, and then they throw in the espresso. It is literally stained milk, the latte macchiato. Macchiato means a stain, right? It comes in a glass usually, and this is how Italians teach babies how to drink coffee. That's where it's from Italy, okay. On that side, we find the cafe latte. It's an American invention, right? It's when Italians try to teach Americans to drink coffee, they gave them cappuccinos, and the Americans were like, oh, it's a bit too strong, because they were used to drinking brown water, basically, in North America. Oh, the cappuccino is quite strong. So they just made the cups bigger and threw in more milk, and then you have the milky coffee, the cafe latte, the milk cafe, right? It's different. It's espresso first, and then the milk, and then you can make latte art. That is the potential for a wow moment. Train your barista, right? So that they can make latte art. Instagrammable. Oh, look at that. Oh, I do that. So, and that's how Italians teach Americans how to drink coffee. That's different. So, I order my cafe latte, I get a latte macchiato, and I tell the barista, that's not a cafe latte. And then the barista says to me, that's the same thing. And then I tell the barista, well, if that's the same thing, then the barista is the same as a plumber. You obviously don't care about the order of the fluids, which is quite relevant. So, coffee with milk is not milk with coffee. Let that be clear. So that's what you can discover when you do journey mapping, right? What are the frustrations of the customer? Just have the camera there and look at their face and how are they responding to the cafe latte while you're serving them a latte macchiato. And where does that sit in the innovation vortex? That sits over here, that sits over here. Like sensing what is happening with our customers when we offer what we made external to them, what we build for them, we sense and then we learn. So that's on that side of the vortex. So I have a self-assessment test, a little colorful tool that you could use in your retrospectives with your team. to be critical towards yourselves. How innovative are we? Are we touching upon all the streams? Do we do a little bit of empathizing? Do we have enough hypothesizing? Do we do enough sensitizing? We need to do all of that at some point in order to be truly, truly innovative. And then we get to the second key to solving the innovator's dilemma. On that side, we have exploration, disruptive innovation. That's what the young ones do, the startups. That's their jobs, to come up with completely new things. Over there, we have sustaining innovation. That's the adults. They still try to innovate. They try to lengthen their midlife crisis, basically, by staying relevant for a bit longer. But it's more slow. The learning is more slow for people like me. And then you have the innovation vortex spinning like crazy over here. But when the company or the business goes bigger, the vortex is also bigger. Many more people are involved. And maybe you could even have some people specialize in some of the streams. Like one person is just responsible, so out there for empathizing with people and recording what they're doing and et cetera. That's because they're good at that. You don't have such people when you're building a new product here, because then you need a cross-functional team that can do everything. So that changes. So the second key is gradually shifting from disruptive innovation to sustaining innovation. It depends where you are with the maturity stage of your business model. Now the third key, last one. So I was part of this innovation steering committee, and one thing that we did wrong was we tried to predict which of the ideas submitted to us would be a great success. Well, there were only three ideas in the box, so that was not difficult to predict. None of them would be a great success. But suppose there were 100 in them. Good luck. How do you predict which one of those will be a great success? Which idea to put all your effort behind? That doesn't work. We were looking at innovation as if it was going through a pipeline. Once you put it in here, it has to go through the entire pipeline and then get out on the other end. Like, we were basically trying to excrete innovation. That's what we were trying to do. Doesn't work. One of my favorite videos is this one by Robert Cooper, who came up with the stage gate model, and he has a really nice metaphor for it.
The first thing to remember is it's a bit like playing poker. When you sit down at the poker table and you start betting, you don't put all your money on the table. You put maybe $2 or 2 euros, and you get a few cards. And then you bet a little bit more money, and you get a few more cards and more information. In other words, new product projects, you never bet all the money at the beginning. It's a stepwise process. It's an incremental commitment. As you learn more, you bet more.
As you learn more, you bet more. That is the key. You, like poker players, they don't put all the money at the beginning on the table. You shouldn't do that with new product development either, because you don't know what is the value of your hand of cards. You have to buy information, basically. So you start with a small budget. And then if that turns out to be okay, then you make the budget a little bit bigger and bigger and bigger. That's how the whole startup scene works. In the beginning, they barely have any money, those startups. But based on their first achievements, they can go to angel investors and they look at the actual evidence of actual performance. And here's a small budget. Now with this, try to make it to the next stage. And then again, plenty of startups fail, but a few remain. They're able to produce evidence, and then they get to the next stage, and then they get to venture capitalists, and they get bigger budgets. It's like playing poker. So I assume that innovation was a pipeline, but it isn't. It is a funnel. It is like a game. It's like an arena. You have lots of ideas starting at stage one, and the further you get, the more and more should be removed out of the game. It is like Game of Thrones. In season one, lots of contenders for the Iron Throne. And season by season, more of them are killed off. There's hardly any family left by the time you get to season eight. Same thing. Hunger Games. You can come up with an endless number of of examples of parallels. Here's another one.
She's living la vida loca. She'll push and pull. It sounded like 2 3-year-olds who've got flu trying to sing.
I love Simon Cowell. It's amazing, the insults that he comes up with. Much better than I have. But anyway, that's why his net worth is 300 million and mine is just 3 euros, basically. So, but yeah, this is the Innovation Committee, new style, Innovation Board 3.0, I could say. They don't try to predict which of the contestants in the very first stage is going to be the winner and give them a contract. That doesn't make any sense. No, they have a program, they have a game, a contest, with the stages defined, and stage by stage, more and more are removed. Call all the bad ones and let them perform again and again. In the meantime, they can practice and they can learn, and by the time they get to the last stage, you have a few left who are all amazing. You will sure to have a winner by that time. That is how innovation should work in a company as well. So, that's the third key. Grow your own great game of business. How are you managing your funnel, not your pipeline, your funnel of ideas? And that is how you can have a startup culture, but at the same time also a scale-up culture. You can have it both ways. You can have, as the British would say, your cake and eat it. And this is a picture that I'm still working on. I beg your forgiveness for looking complicated, but it's a work in progress. But it tries to summarize what I have just told you about. You have the funnel here, and I like drawing it bottom to top because, yes, it is like a game. It is like a contest. People should feel that they reached the next level, that they have achieved, earned with their progress and their evidence and their validated learning, that they earned the next level. And over here, you have the gatekeepers. They're like the investors, but in a company, you could have similar gatekeepers who decide based on the actual validated learning, the evidence, the demo days that they do for the innovation board, whether or not they earned the right to the next chunk of the budgets. And by the extra stage, the budgets get bigger. It's possible because half is removed at every stage, basically. Robert Cooper, in his work, says that there is a 60-to-1 attrition rate from stage 1 to stage 7. This is all the ideas, and these are the profitable business models. Imagine that out of the 60 ideas, one will be a profitable product. Now, you try to predict which one that is in the idea box. Good luck. You can't. So you'll just have to make the budgets available, create the program, create the game. And exploration turns into execution gradually. In the beginning, lots of exploration by the startups, but the further they get, the more they will have to execute. And the rules of the game will change. What you expect from the entrepreneurs in the beginning will be very different from what you'll expect from the startup units and the scale-up units by the time they get here. They will be treated more and more like adults. More and more, they will have to play the rules by the rules of the people over there. And this, I think, this is my hypothesis, but I'm trying to test it. This, I think, is one of the reasons why we have so many failed agile transformations around the world. Some say 70% of agile transformations are failing or stalling. I don't know if that percentage is true. I don't care. I just hear people complaining all the time. Well, it's nothing. It's not working. Why is it not working? Because you're trying to treat everyone the same. That makes no sense. Form should follow function, right? What is the function? That's determined by the business model. So the form, the rules, depend on the business model that you have. The way people work over here should not be the way people work over there. It's an entirely different way of operating. So yes, it is totally fine if you have certain ways of compensation that work for profitable business models. But we intrapreneurs should be compensated in very different ways. We should be rewarded for exploring, not for executing, which is what happens all the time in large companies, that everyone is rewarded for executing. Well, if that's what you do, good luck with your innovation. It's not going to take off. That's just one example. Another thing that Robert Cooper has pointed out, and Peter Drucker, and many of the experts I talked about also yesterday during my two-day workshop that I had here in Warsaw. Everything that happens here should not be the responsibility of the profitable business models over there. And this is exactly the problem of many companies, that innovation is made a responsibility of the adults over there. That doesn't work. Because these have a focus on making money. They will never, ever give priority to new product development. They will see that as cannibalization of their current business models. So you need to separate it. You must make sure that someone from the executive team is responsible for everything that happens here from stage one to stage five. Like, someone is responsible for all the kids. Keep them separate from the adults. Only when they graduate from the teenage years, become an adult, then they can play with the other adults. But we keep them separate, otherwise they're going to eat them. They're going to eat them alive in big companies. So what can we do about the frameworks and the methods and the toolboxes and everything? Well, keep them for sure, because there's so much good stuff out there. I'm not trying to throw anything away that's already been done, but they're not complete, these pictures. I think we need to do more. We have to figure out, how does Spotify model work compared to lifecycle stages? How does SAFe work compared to lifecycle stages? Where does Scrum fit, for example? I had a whole discussion with my group yesterday of Scrum already making assumptions about where you are in a lifecycle stage. We need to understand what those assumptions are and play the rules, play by the rules accordingly. So if you find it interesting, I invite you to sign up and have this discussion with me, because I am on a journey here. I'm just figuring it out as I go. And happy to have that conversation with some people here in the audience. Just go to the URL and start talking with me and my team. So the interesting thing is, the innovator's dilemma has been solved long ago. We call it nature. The species versus organisms. Species, theoretically, can live a very long time. Crocodiles and alligators, they've been around for millions of years. How do they do that? By continuously regenerating with newborns that grow up and die. Style up, scale up, and screw up endlessly. It never stops. But this is how companies evolve. This is how species can evolve and keep up with changing environment. So the only way not to be disrupted is to disrupt yourself. We can summarize it as, go forth and make more babies. Thank you so much for listening.